So you probably think, in our modern world, we understand all of our physical spaces. But it's not true. There are many spaces that are either too small or too dangerous for humans to enter. We can use robots to explore these spaces and give us information we couldn't get otherwise. I've spent my career building robots to do all kinds of things, quite often deploying robots in difficult situations that's quite challenging, and often learning lessons the hard way. For example, that you shouldn't sit on a chair on a sand dune. Clearly not a good idea. But only recently has it occurred to me that exploration robots are really going to make a difference to our lives. So you probably think, well, this is strange. Why would exploration robots really have an impact upon my life? Well, one of the things that it will do is, under our feet, there are literally millions of miles of pipes. We've all been there going to work in the morning. You get stuck with road work, digging up pipes, trying to repair the pipes. These pipes will fail. They need repair. And right now, pretty much, they get repaired by digging a big hole and fixing it. What we can do in the future is have robots in these pipes to either inspect them before they become damaged, or in fact, even repair them. So we'll be going to work, we'll have no idea, under our feet, a small robots repairing pipes. It sounds like science fiction, but it's certainly coming, it's certainly here. We've been doing some work looking at how we can build robots to go inside pipes. So we've got here a pipe climbing robot, a prototype robot. Pipes, in fact, are quite complex. So you have long sections of very flat, sort of straight pipes, but you also have pipes that are quite complex. They bend, they twist, they have obstacles in them. So you need some kind of robot that has quite a bit of dexterity. So our robots use what's called an inchworm process. That is that it has rubber discs that come out and grip the pipe at one point, in this case on the top. Then you release the bottom rubber grippers. Then the robot contracts. Then you grip the other side and vice versa. So you keep doing this gripping and extending motion, inchworm motion. By doing that, you can travel along the pipe, getting great traction. So you do this, and also this robot here can also do maneuvers where the actual top rubber pads can move around. They can kind of move in different directions, so you can steer around corners and even choose to go in different directions. So you've got a T-junction in different directions. So certainly in 20 years, these things will be under your feet. We've taken this similar kind of concept, and we've done some work to explore the Pyramid of Egypt. Again, you probably think, well, the pyramid is kind of a strange place to explore robots. But there are spaces in that pyramid that have lain undiscovered, literally, for thousands of years. So we've been looking at how we can do this. If you take the pyramid, if you slice it in half, you would see a central chamber, and you would see shafts going from the central chamber towards the outer casing. These shafts are so-called air shafts. Don't penetrate the outer casing. They go up. At some point, they kind of get blocked by a blocking stone, and they don't penetrate the outer casing. So the question is, what are these air shafts for? And also, is there something behind the end of the termination shaft? So the scenario we have is like what I'm showing here. So at the end of the shaft, you have a stone which has been nicknamed the first blocking stone. It's a stone that sits there. It basically terminates the end of the shaft. We know it's there. We know behind this, there is some kind of space. Again, we don't know quite how big or what it is. And behind that, what's called the second blocking stone. Again, it's a stone. It could be part of a massive pyramid. It could be a 15-ton block. Or it could be another kind of doorway to something else. These shafts, by the way, are actually 200 millimeters by 200 millimeters. They're really quite small. So clearly, we can't put a person inside there to explore it. We need some kind of robotic technology. So we've built an inchworm-type robot. It works on a very similar principle to the previous robot in the fact that it has pads on the front, pads on the rear. These pads extend and retract, and also the central carriage goes backwards and forwards. So you can do an inchworm motion through these shafts. We have to travel 50 meters, so it's clearly a long way up these shafts. We have 15 cameras. One of the things when you climb on these shafts is it's immensely stressful. You can probably imagine. You're in the shafts, and if it gets stuck, it really gets stuck. So you have to be able to see what's going on, perceive what's going on in the environment with all these different cameras. This photograph was taken on the morning before our most successful ascent up the shaft. And on this day, nothing worked. As you can probably imagine, all of these, the technology is just terrible sometimes. So we lost our camera feeds, we lost our sensors, and all this kind of thing. Eventually, we managed to patch it together to climb the shaft. But quite interestingly, when we got to the top of the shaft, it all started working. So for some reason on that day, fate really did shine upon us, and we were able to see what's going on. So at the top of the shaft, you see this kind of, this is a blocking stone here. So it's a heavily decorated stone, pristine limestone, with a hole drilled by a previous team who just looked in the hole and couldn't see anything. You'll also notice the copper handles. These are ornate handles. No one's really sure what they're for, but they certainly are decorative. So this is what we got there. We saw this. Fantastic. We carry on our robot tools, such as a drill and the snake camera. The snake camera is a very small tool that can go through a hole and have a dexterous end that can look around and see what's going on. You can see here the picture of the actual snake arm going through. On this particular day, we ran out of time, so you can imagine how difficult this was. With this situation here, we've got it all set up, the camera's there, time to go home. The next day, we had to come and find out what was going on, but we were quite good and quite fortunate in the fact we did find writing hidden for 4,500 years, some red figures. These figures probably indicate numbers, which are probably symbolic towards the actual length of the shaft. So it's really quite a nice result. We haven't yet probed the second blocking stone, which is the one behind the first one. And ideally, we'd better drill that hole and move forward. So I've shown you here a very kind of simple snake arm. So it's like a pole with a small dexterous arm on the end. We can use snake cameras to explore much more complex situations. So for example, in search and rescue, a building collapses down. You've got one wall you can drill a hole through. You want to drill a hole. You want to insert some kind of flexible, dexterous robot through that hole and see behind what's going on to look for survivors, for example. So we've built quite a few of these kind of snake robots. You'll see here a link of one of our snake robots. So a snake robot is basically lots of bars with articulated joints between them that can be controlled to move in a flexible way. So you put it through a hole, it can move and you can look around. This particular snake arm is 12 millimeters in diameter. So it's really quite thin, so it's quite a small hole, which is quite useful. To articulate the joints, you have to pull on wires. So inside that small diameter bar are high tension wires. You pull on these wires, you can move the snake arm and look around. One of the things with this, though, is that because it's such a small diameter, you need huge amounts of force to move this thing. So we've gone from this very delicate, kind of nice, pristine little snake arm to an enormous system which can provide hundreds of newtons of force. This is required to be able to apply enough tension to move it. And in fact, in our work, we've shown that for a 12 millimeter diameter bar, using current material science, the maximum length we can get is 3 meters. So clearly, this kind of technology is fine if you want to look quite close through a hole. If you want to explore much further through the hole, you need a different kind of technique. So we've also built another kind of robot, which is a borehole robot, which can actually go through the hole and can explore much further. So in this case here, it's a slightly bigger diameter. You can look through it, you can insert your robot through it. It goes through in a straight line. On the other side, it reconfigures into a conventional tracked vehicle. Then you can drive and explore for hundreds of meters beyond the actual entrance point. So clearly it's a much more versatile system than having the conventional type snake robot. I do think, though, that actually the biggest challenge for us is really yet to come, the biggest exploration. You're probably thinking, well, is that kind of exploring Mars? Is there some kind of really intricate place to go? In my opinion, the biggest place for robot exploration is inside our bodies. So we, in the future, will have robots that can come inside our bodies, they can perform diagnostic procedures, but not only that, be able to repair us, make us better. So already we know we have a thing called minimally invasive surgery. In this case here, you inflate the abdomen, you make a small incision, and you can insert tools, straight tools, into your stomach and perform surgery. One of the challenges here is it's very hard to see what's going on. You can imagine you've got a very small, kind of slender viewpoint, a couple of cameras. It's very hard to perform complex procedures. Ideally, what we'd want is some kind of robot that can go inside our body, it could move around, walk around, give us a different perspective on our surgery. So we've been doing some work in this, and we've developed a robot called Frogbot, as you'll see here. So nicknamed Frogbot because it's inspired by the tree frog. So you want to go inside the body, you want to be able to stick upside down on the stomach lining and walk around. So how would you do that? How would you make a robot stick inside the body? Well, the tree frog has great sticky feet. On its feet, you'll see it has these small things, these small little micro pillars. These actually serve to form adhesion to wet tissue. So we fabricated these little pillars, and we use these to create a robot that can actually stick to wet objects and walk around and move around. We built a robot, which is 8 motors. So it's quite a complex robot. It needs to be quite complex to be able to do the full walking motions. You can imagine sort of a four-legged little animal walking around. It's quite complex. So it's an 8 actuator robot to walk around on this kind of thing. And it works really well. But you can see here, it's really quite large. I'm not going to ask for any volunteers to put a 600 by 600 millimeter robot inside your body. Clearly, it's quite big. So the future for this kind of work is to try and really drive down the size of these things. How can we make complex robots that are all integrated together? Well, we know that in the future, we've got 3D printing, even now, in fact, 3D printing. So we can make complex mechanical structures quite straightforwardly. What we can't do is make these structures with integrated electronics, sensors, and computation. So in the future, we'll be able to make these systems all complicated together, quite small, so we can perform this surgery. So in summary, I'm absolutely convinced that exploration robots will not only make your lives better, it'll make them longer. Thank you.